first of all would compliment Young Lives and all others who are associated for this study. You know, we do not have many longitudinal studies on record. A large number of studies are cross-sectional, and it rarely happens that studies are carried over a period of time. We have some studies on record, particularly from the Institute of Nutrition, the study by Gopalan and by Pranav Ganguly, and these studies continued for a long time. Generally, what happens in longitudinal studies that the researchers lose interest and then they leave. So this is really, and I want to compliment them for this work. The second thing I want to compliment them is that they are working on children. I am reminded of Edwin Ardiner, who used the term called muted lot. There are certain categories of people who are muted. They don't speak. They are silenced. They don't speak because they do not want to speak, but because they are silenced. The structure of dominance is so powerful that it does not allow these people to speak. And whenever they speak in the idiom of dominance. So they do not have their own way of putting the thing. And here, they are making an effort to listen to children. In fact, one of the write-ups which has been circulated is on qualitative research. So it will not be it will be wrong to say that they are not entering into qualitative aspect. In fact, I am reminded of an article by Ward Goodenough. It was published in Current Anthropology. The title of that article was "Why Anthropologists Do Not Listen to Children." When they go for their field work, first-hand field work, and they spend a long time with the community, almost 1 year or so, they avoid, underquote, they avoid children. They don't listen to children. And they use children mainly for establishing rapport. So they give gifts to children, they give toffees to children, so that they become friendly with children, and the children take them to their parents. But when it comes to collecting data from children, and is there a separate methodology which is to be used for the study of children, they are silent, because we have not paid much attention to this. I will add to this that we do not have any ethnography which describes in terms of what Clifford Geertz called thick description, the lives of children. We do not have. We have ethnographies on mother-child relations. We have ethnographies on reproductive health. We have ethnographies on normal men and women. But we do not have many ethnographies about these muted lots. So who listens to children? Here, there are people who are listening. Here, there are people who are documenting, and therefore I must compliment. However, having said this, I feel, and this is my personal view, I feel that this division of certain facts which cannot be quantified, the certain facts which cannot be measured, but all facts, whether they happen to be quantitative or they are qualitative, they have to be interpreted. They have to be interpreted. And interpretation is a part of imagination. You have to have the wings of imagination. You have to have this qualitative aspect. So I feel really disturbed, having done advanced statistics and having taught quantitative methods. In fact, I teach a paper on research method where I teach all these, you know, right up to transformation and all the computer-aided program. I feel a little disturbed that this kind of a division, that here is quantitative thing, have a break, then we will have the qualitative thing. I find this a little disturbing. You think about it. I wrote a dissertation as an MSc student on karyotyping, on chromosomal analysis. And later on, I wrote a thesis on management of resources by a community in Rajasthan. And I found that chromosomes had to be interpreted in the same way. You know, the cultural environment has to be understood in terms of facts which are quantifiable and facts which cannot be quantified. Therefore, I would perhaps had I been you, I would have perhaps not used these terms quantitative or qualitative. I would have said, these are the researches we are doing on children. We are trying to understand the group of children, and we are trying to understand the lives of individual children. Now, there was one presentation where it said, we focus on children and not on families. It is disturbing, because how can you look at children away from families? The children will lead you to families. The families will lead you to community. Communities will lead you to what is called society. We have to look at all these interlinkages. Then what exactly you are doing is that you are researching children, and you are researching children longitudinally. You are researching children making use of the facts which are quantifiable and facts which are not quantifiable, looking at the relationship between them. Therefore, this whole debate will be verbose, it will be unproductive, and it will be polemical. Therefore, I would like to avoid this kind of thing. Sometimes, you know, we tend to place a lot of emphasis on numbers because we think they are scientific, and all other things are storytelling. They are anecdotal. Someone used the term anecdotal. But after all, narratives are a part of human life. How can you avoid these narratives? And if it is so, I would not go with you on this. Perhaps when you hold another seminar, perhaps you could say, these are the findings of our researches, without emphasizing that these are quantities and these are not. And you sometimes, you know, when we say, oh, these are the statistical tools we have, we try to mythologize that they are great things, you know, others can't understand. But when in fact, you know, those who are mathematicians, they know how simple mathematics is. In the same way, when you've learned the statistics, you find how simple it is. How simple it is. Therefore, this kind of mythologization should not be there. So these are the researches, and these are very, very good researches, very, very valuable researches. And say the experiences of education, the experiences of social protection or of nutrition, they can always be thickly described, humanistically described, with the help of cases, with the help of the real lives of children. And in fact, this is what I do now. I think, and this is my very humble submission, think about it. We are always field working. We are always collecting data. Wherever we are seeing. You know, every day when I go to the university, I look at some of these bastis which have come up and the children who are playing. I often wonder, what is that they do throughout the day? And I often send my student to go and live with them, to go and just be around and see, try to experience their life, have some kind of an empathy for this. And no human research can begin without empathy. And therefore, this is important we understand. Finally, just a little comment. I felt a little concerned about this relationship between caste and cognitive skills. In fact, caste is a huge term. Caste is a matter of biology. Caste is a matter of psychology. Caste is a matter of sociology. Caste is too much. And when we say caste and innate skills are interrelated, or there's some kind of a dependent or independent relationship between them, we are saying too much. In fact, which aspects of caste are you concerned with? You are concerned with economy of caste. You are concerned with educational level of caste. Perhaps it may be a little better, I think, to avoid the word caste, because caste is a problematic category. There are castes within caste, and there are one who collects the data, analyzes it, writes it up, and makes the presentation. So perhaps it may be, I'm not saying that don't have this division of labor, but I'm submitting, in addition to all this, have few ethnographers. These ethnographers should study the lives of few children. And in fact, you know, this is not the first time that I felt it. Many years ago, when I was doing my field work in Rajasthan, I was associated briefly with a project in Rajasthan called Urmul. And the project was the impact of the aid on the lives of people. And again, questionnaire running into pages, people run away. You know, you have already seen that 14 people, seven from one cohort, seven from, they refused because they found that the questionnaire was threatening. You see, and sometimes, you know, in questionnaire research, people tell you what you want to hear because they want to get rid of you. Huh? So they just want to tell you that. So I suggested to them that I entirely agree with survey, asking questions to people. But please leave a couple of your researchers in these villages. And just let these researchers be there. Let them listen to, let them be just observers. And they will be able to tell you a lot. What people say when you are not around, when these reactivity syndromes are not there. So just leave these. And I tell you, later on I came to know that those documents which were presented by these ethnographers who just lived there for a long time, they were very valuable. And these documents can help you in formulating hypotheses, they can help you in preparing questionnaires. So please, if possible, think of the possibility of keeping some of these ethnographers who go with nothing but a piece of paper and pen and just live with people, who listen to people, who do not intervene, who do not ask questions, who want to observe what people do in their normal circumstances, in their normal life. It will be immensely rich. I wish you all the best. And if there's anything I can do for you, I'll always be available. But these are some of the things which came to my mind. Today, the value of ethnographic research is being recognized by nursing, by medicine, by architecture, by engineering, by all these departments, by pediatricians, by community health specialists, by everyone, that it is better to know fewer things because you can generalize on that basis. So some of these things can be really enriching, and you will do a great service to academicians, to academic life, by producing such documents. In fact, I come from the university. I am not associated with any of these NGOs and consultancy. I tell you, the academicians look down upon NGO research. In one of the August seminars, a very distinguished speaker, I would not like to name him, he used the term, "Oh, today research has become NGOized." He used the phrase NGOization of research, which is very fast. It is produced like Aladdin's chirag, you know, you just go and collect some facts and bring it. And he compared it with the university research, which takes place slowly, gradually. You spend time, mulling over the facts and so on and so forth. So they look down upon. But that is not true. That is not true. I have been teaching courses on research methodology, in which I include the methodological cluster of PRA, RRA, PLA, and their various variants. But what actually is happening is that these NGO researchers, the findings of the NGO researchers, are usually not brainstormed with a group of academicians. What ma'am was suggesting, which has happened today. We have learned, personally, I have learned a lot from this. I copiously, profusely, I took the notes. And this kind of a partnership, this kind of an interaction will be helpful for us and also for you. With these comments, I wish you all the best and thanks a lot. We'll meet again, inshallah.
Thank you all of the people present here. I won't have time to name the people who are present. In total, I thank all the people participating throughout the day and making their valuable time and having an active participation. I thank to all my staff of CCIP and Young Lives who have been coordinating last 1 month for the success of the seminar. especially thanks to the Media Centre who have been continuously shooting, maybe not interest of the people from the Media Centre, they have been shooting throughout the day. Thank you so much for the recording. Thank you all.